Now on 4, we take our second visit to Glastonbury for more live music from Jimmy Page and Robert Plant.
Well, welcome back to Glastonbury 95, where it is getting extremely hot and things are getting a bit disgusting in some ways, particularly in the food area. I went to catering and went to get some butter to put on my butty, and the butter bowl, it just turned into a steaming vat of bubbling liquid, which wouldn't have been that disgusting, but three of the levellers were swimming in it.
I too have had a crisis. Yesterday it was the lack of sun, no problems there, but today my sunglasses broke. Kel horror! But being a complete showbiz lovey, I've ordered there, but anyway, the others are gone off sunbathing, leaving us two here in a mellow mood. We've got a great mix of music and features for you. Take That, Robbie gives us his impressions of Glastonbury.
Wow.
We've got Verve, we've got Anita Tickerham, and headlining at this hour, as far as we're concerned, Page and Plant.
Yeah, you can hear them. He's on there, isn't he? He's doing a bit of his proper rock singer. Hey, man, I like the way you move! And all that sort of stuff. So you've got loads of that coming up.
Yeah, actually,
well, he's not quite as good as me, in my opinion. But,
he's got more hair, but apart from that.
If you're not at Glastonbury, then obviously you're not, because you're watching this on the telly, so smart, eh? But to get the full effect, what you should do is open the patio door, stick the telly in the back garden, nestle your head on a clod of compacted dung, settle back and enjoy Tanita Tickerham.
Read the papers, read them good and well. pretty people, nervous people, people have got to sell. News you have to sell. And if my eyes are just hollow eyes, if your love is drawn from my hands, from my hands, you know you'll never be more than twist in my sobriety, more than twist in my sobriety. And if my eyes are just hollow eyes, if your love is from my hands, from my hands, you know you'll never be more than twist in my sobriety, more than twist in my sobriety, more than.
Adam on it, and he's going to play the accordion, Mr. Adam Kerr. Thank you.
This good, this not love and hate, stand by your side, this is good. This not love and hate, stand by your side. For the rain may fall, Father's calling you, you still feel safe inside. May you march too loud, your brother's ignoring you, you still feel safe inside. Was it so? Was it yesterday? Was it true for you? Of all the choices you have made, did do a lot for you. Of daily smiles, children play, all the bad things happen miles away, and strong things care about you. You hold your head up while the rest of us try to call the stations, call the people we all want to know. Cause while all the rest have taken time, you don't want to know. This not love and hate, stand by your side. This is good. This not love and hate, stand by your side. When the rain may fall, Father's calling you, you still feel safe inside. When you march too loud, brother's ignoring you, you still feel safe inside. Oh, was it solo? Was it yesterday? Was it true?
Room there. Now we all know about the main themes of Glastonbury. Music, love, peace, mung beans, veggie burgers, you know the thing, basically anything and everything goes. So you have to be prepared to see a lot of odd, exciting and unfamiliar things. Coming up now is something I have to say I I have never seen in my life before, which begs the question, what the hell is it? You care to explain, Dan?
It's a bicycle powered sound system.
Yeah.
And we're displaying alternative energy to people in a fun and imaginative way.
So you just have bought a stereo?
We could, but we get a big sound off this and we can make as many people enjoy it as possible.
Let's have a look along. Let's take us through the system. We'll do a bit of a tomorrow's
okay.
world.
Come on,
Bill, come in. Nice to see Van Morrison back at Glastonbury. And how's it working? This is the engine room, Billy,
Yes, the old engine was originally designed for flying doctor service in Tanzania.
All right, yeah.
To assist African villages in shortwave communication. So they had something like a bicycle, they pedaled away, generated electricity.
Yeah.
And then they had shortwave communication between the villages. So it's something like a pedal power telephone.
Okay, so they provide the power in. So what happens in your gypsy caravan do down here?
Right, now you've got the full PA system here, you've got record decks, stack machines, and also we've got a transmitter receiver set which we can receive signals.
Right.
And we can rebroadcast. As we're on the move.
Did they have the DAC machines in Tanzania as well? Was that a bad
thing? Only if we're very lucky.
Right, okay. I'm right to the front. What happens to this bit?
On the front, we've got pager power.
Hey, I'll tell you what, it's loud, isn't it?
Very, very
it's
loud.
It's louder than pager plums, I'll tell you that. Anyway, sorry, carry on, Bill.
So we've got two bicycle frames side by side. This is our forward tractor, and it's pulled the vehicle along.
Nice, fantastic. And this is going into mass production, isn't it, this, you
can... Very, very hopefully. There's millions of them, we hope. Well, we just change every crew all the time.
Okay, so there's a big stop in the music and then you start on again.
People are very keen to pedal.
I think it's going to catch on, and the hot news is that the Osric Tentacles have just ordered one to use as the next tour bus. Anyway, we'll have more music now from the NME stage, some true Glastonbury crusties. It's Menswear. Blinkin' heck, I kid.
To Midtown Times Square, met a girl he knows called Pursuit. Tessie said, "I don't understand how they grow tomatoes in a can." Tessie said, "I wait a while, my teeth don't glitter when I smile." She had problems with his personal hygiene, and the coffee he drinks is full of caffeine. She said, "Tommy, take a bath for me. Your stink, I'll scrub you to your sweet and clean." Tessie said, "I don't understand how to grow tomatoes in a can." Tessie said, "Now wait. La 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 la
Hello, I'm Robbie from Take That, and I'm down to experience Glastonbury for the second time. I came down last year. I had a really good time, and I thought I'd come down this time. I nearly went on one there. I'm enjoying myself, like everybody here. But because the sort of band that I'm in, people are looking at me as if to say, you're not supposed to be here. It's like I'm a Man United fan in the Cop End at Liverpool or something. Zit on somebody's nose. But I admire that. I enjoy that. So what's going on? The sanitary's awful. The food's appalling. The music's crap. The beer's great.
That was Robbie from Take That. I mean, you don't expect to see him here, but they've had Rolf Harris on and Tom Jones. Perhaps next year, Take That will be headlining Glastonbury.
Could never happen.
I'm Mark Radcliffe, and you are?
I'm Sonia Saul, it's partner in crime for this show. Do stay tuned, because we have John Peel's Glastonbury coming up very soon, plus we have Paige and Plant. But right now, you may have seen a taste of them in the earlier show. Now you're going to get a full glut. It's The Verve.
away from deeply spiritual Wigan, those were the Verve. Of course, another thing you can do a lot of at Glastonbury is shopping, and people say that you buy clothes at Glastonbury, never wear them again, but that's ridiculous. I mean, all you need to do is buy wisely, I think, and I mean, you know, you can wear things anywhere. Anyway, now, John, nice to see you. See, you've dressed up for the occasion.
Yeah, well, this is my working overalls.
Obviously. Yeah, this is John McCririck who does all that. Whatever it is. No, it's not.
It's John Rowe. It's John Rowe. Rowe. That's the one.
Okay, so what are you doing?
I do storytelling, and then I'll paint the children up in the kids' field.
Really? Okay, yeah. Right. If they've been naughty, people live with you.
Oh, yeah, they leave them with me, and 6 days later, I pick them up again.
Okay, quick point for the kids.
Oh, yeah, my little brother, ever so sweet, that you should see the things he eats. Dirt and grass and sticks and stones. He even tried an old dog's bone. My little brother will eat anything at all, but will he eat mushy peas when he gets to school?
That's truly lovely. And if I have kids, I'm going to make sure that you tell them stories about.
Why, thank you very much.
That's all right. That's really quite all right. Anyway, John Peel, a doyen of Glastonbury, gives us his impressions. This is My Glastonbury.
Multifaceted, actually, is my role, really. I have to be, first of all, I have to do 2 Radio 1 programmes. Well, I've done one of them, and I've got another one to do. And doesn't obviously, most of it's sorted out by other people, really, in that they've been recording bands and editing them feverishly, and I just sit there and claim all the credit for it. My principal role, though, is that of parent, and scattered behind me here, which they're not supposed to be there, I don't think, actually, rows of tents. Crammed with my children and their unsuitable friends. Well, I went for a melancholy walk last night, you see, because I was very worried because our William was something like 3 hours late arriving due to train chaos, and he had a similar experience with the gates to the ones that I had. People say, yes, that way, mate, and you go through and you find yourself in a completely wrong place. And, no, you have to go back down the relief road, and it happened to him 5 times until he eventually threatened somebody, which isn't like him at all. And, of course, it's only when that happens that you get things sorted out. So they all came, arrived wildly overexcited, and they all disappeared into the night, except for Flossie, who's 13, and her maid Zoe, who stayed in the tent. And then I went for a long and melancholy walk by myself, and, thinking, my goodness, we have, while, if I'm such a fascinating person, well, how come I'm on my own at this stage of the proceedings? I just like coming here. I like the atmosphere, generally. I like some of the unsuitable and fattening foods that they serve, and incidentally, I quite like some of the music, you know, but the music I relegate, not to secondary, well, I suppose, yeah, almost to secondary importance to the event itself, which it usually is the case at festivals anyway. I mean, it's not often at any festival that you get an absolutely dazzling performance that you go away thinking, wow, this has changed my life. Things have changed a lot. I came to the very first one, although Michael Eavis tells me that I didn't, but I believe that I did. But I've been to the last 5, which isn't a lot, I know, but things have changed quite a bit during that time, which I've characterised, actually, it sounds like it's a rather flippant thing to say, but it's true, in that you now encounter people backstage who are wearing aftershave. I don't wake up in the morning and think, wow, it's the 25th anniversary of Glastonbury. I mean, not completely without nostalgia, you know. I don't sit and listen to Beatles records and think about when I was thinner and taller and had more hair and all of those things. No, I can't remember anything about that first festival, not because I was so completely out of my head. But you have to remember that, you know, that whole of that sort of 60s period, there were festivals all the time. I mean, I was off to festivals on an almost weekly basis, compaying a lot of them, getting paid for very few. I mean, there were people running shoe shops in Nottingham would suddenly get the idea, look, this is true, you know, they'd say, well, let's run a festival, and they'd get status quo. Or something. I remember saying this, and there were bands, Edgar Broughton Band, of course, was every single one that you went to, the Edgar Broughton Band was paying. There even went to a few of them with them, you know, in a Bedford dormobile with their mum and dad who did the roadieing, stopping in lay-bys to make soup and stuff. Like, I mean, that's the whole point of festivals in the first place, I think, was to give you a sense of community, you know, that even if the music was crap and the weather was awful and the toilets were nauseating, you could feel that you were part of a kind of community. It's all right, you know, they come and put you in this caravan, which is not unpleasant, and there's no money in it, you know, it's not, people think, well, I bet you're getting a couple of grand, John, you know, but what I get is free admission for the children and the use of this caravan. And Chris Evans, I think, gets Blenheim Palace. La, 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 la.
Glastonbury. Before the break, you saw John Peel's impression of Glastonbury because, hey, it's a real personal thing, man. Now we are back tonight at 11 o'clock with some huge bands, amongst them Elastica, Simple Minds, and The Cure.
That's right, but we got a big finish. Oh, I've just noticed I've got a bell sticking the wrong way. Honestly, you look, try and look smart and show busy on the telly, and you come all stupid, all goes horribly things on. Right, yes, they've not been together for 18 years. They used to leave the greatest rock band the world ever saw. The classic lineup, the classic four-piece rock band, Led Zepp, Norse God lead singer, skinny guitar hero, thug of a bricklayer on the drums and a bass player no one knew much about. And the first time I came to Glastonbury, I bought a silk blouse in honour of Robert Plant, and blow me, they're together for the first time in 18 years. It's Jimmy Page who's got the silk blouse, but I've got a bit of shib on. Jimmy Page and Robert Plant. Wow! Go on, give him a big build-up. We're going to have loads of this.
Hell yeah, man! Oh, that's the highlight of the show.
We're going to make you sweat.
We're going
to make you warm.
Thank you. you very kindly.
Baby, I'm in love. Love, love.